Hello everyone, and welcome to week 7 of our Preparation for Partnership course. I hope you've all had a good week. I hope that you're adjusting to the time having changed. At least we get brighter mornings, even if the evenings are now getting dark rather early. Okay, as an antidote to that talk of darkness, I think we should warm up with our usual EUSDS stroll to the sunny side of the street. Before we learn anything new, let's just dance a little bit of the shag that we've already been learning. So, as a quick reminder of some of the main things we've done, but certainly not all of them because we've done a lot by now, we had our idea of our slows, which could be things like step, flick, with a prep behind if you want to, or could be things like flick, flick, or could be things like lift behind, or could be things like circle behind. In either direction, however you're happy. We had our quick quicks, which could be just things like step, step, where we were, or slide, slide, or run, run, or the hangman kind of quick quicks. We had the idea of going out to the side, so we had things like step, flick, step, 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 flick, step, 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 flick, step, 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 flick. We had things like our shuffles, and our tap if we wanted to change direction, and also the idea of going sideways on the hangman. And we had the idea that we can use step, steps to turn, so we could be doing things like step, flick, step, flick, step, 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 flick, step, flick, step, step. And you can go all the way around if you're on a low friction surface. And last week, we also started to group these two units together into patterns. So we had the sort of single time shag, which had a timing like step, flick, step, 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 flick, step, 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 flick. So slow, quick, quick, slow, quick, quick, slow, quick, quick, slow. We had our double time shag, our slow, slow, quick, quick. And we had the version of that that had got two step, steps, so slow, slow, quick, 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 slow, slow, quick, 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 quick. There are others, but those are the main ones. So what I'm going to do is to put some music on now and just dance anything. So I'll be dancing randomly to sort of fill the space so you're not sitting in an empty hall. But don't follow me. Just dance your own thing. And you may want consciously to choose one of these rhythms and stick to it. Because earlier on, I was very deliberately asking you not to care about large-scale structures and get really used to being able to just move between any of the slows and any of the quick-quicks. But as an additional sort of exercise now, you may want to pick a rhythm and see how well you can stick to it. The world will not stop if you go wrong and pick another rhythm. It's all fine. Okay, I'll put some music on. Thank you. So this week I'm going to pick up on several different topics. So we're going to do a little bit more about preparation, direct preparation for partnership. We're going to do a little bit more of footwork learning. We will have a sensible move of the week, and we'll carry on with the killer boogie routine. To start with the preparation for partnership, it's all preparation for partnership, but to start with the thing that's most specific for that, a couple of weeks ago I spent some time talking about the stance that shag dancers had, and I got rather distracted into giving a whole history of collegiate shag, sorry about that. There's a second bit about stance that I want to talk about, and again it's mildly controversial, so I'm going to give you my take on it and my reasons for my take on it. But if you meet somebody else telling you something else in a workshop, be open, listen to them, and also the dance is going to be yours, so make your own decision about what you like. In a lot of shag, and I'm moving a long way back, one of the hands between partners, when partners are facing each other, so imagine that there is a partner who is you're seeing his or her back and they're facing me now. As a leader, my left hand, I'll turn around to you properly, my left hand is held high, kind of stupidly high. You know, a normal ballroom hold would be something like this. This is very high. It doesn't happen when we're facing a partner. If my partner is sort of out there somewhere, then the hand will be low. But when he or she is close, then my hand will be high. This is, to most people, very much part of the shag look. But a lot of people who have got interested in shag have gone back to old films of the kinds that I've been showing you and have pointed out that particularly, not in the films of social dances, but in the Hollywood-type films, that high hand isn't there. There is a reason for that. So the high hand goes with something else that we'll cover when we're doing actual partner dancing. But with the high hand, obviously your hands can only connect. Sorry, it's off the top of the screen, I know, but it doesn't matter. If you imagine my partner can only connect with that hand if he or she is so close that they're either practically touching or actually touching at chest level. And that is a well-known way of dancing shag. It's not the only way. You can dance with a small gap, or you can dance with a big gap and a low hand. But historians who've looked back at shag, and I will put a link, probably in a subsequent class, to a really long history of shag. But historians who've looked back at this and have done research have said, look, from the old movies they see that were taken casually, the high hand is very much a thing, like that movie I showed you on Venice Beach. But the Hayes Commission were in charge of making sure that nothing that looked too sexually explicit was ever shown in Hollywood films. Those are the sort of rules that meant that if a man and woman were on the bed, one of the man's feet had to be on the floor, and all those sort of ridiculous rules about what had to be done. And they think that the reason that in Hollywood films, shag is often shown with a low hand, and therefore, rather than this close spacing, a bigger spacing between partners, is because the Hayes Commission, there was a risk that they wouldn't like the partners dancing in contact. Tango had exactly the same problem. So that's an argument that actually the social form did have the high hand mostly and the close contact. When we teach, when you are in a partnership, we're going to give everybody a choice about what kind of hold they want, or at least the point is if somebody says they want the more distant hold, then they win with any partnership. So please don't get worried about my talking about close holds. But what I do want to do is to invite you to dance again, but this time to dance with your left hand high. Now, I know I'm saying left hand high, that's a leader's hand that's high. Any of you might choose to lead. Lots of people choose to lead and to follow in different dances. I mean, you know, in dance number one of an evening, there may be a leader, and in dance number two, there may be a follower, and in dance number three, although it's all shag, it's all the same dance in the sense of what we're doing. Followers' hands should always be where the leader guides them to be, so therefore I don't want anybody to practice having a right hand high as a follower, because that's a consequence of the lead, it's not an independent decision. So therefore I'm just going to suggest that we dance again, but do everything you were doing, I mean, not move for move, but the same kind of exercise, but this time with this high hand, and it's a kind of, you know, miss, I've got the answer high, it's properly high. You can't see this, palm flat, forwards. I'm also going to put on some slower music. There are two reasons for this. One is just, this will change your balance, it's something new compared to the way that we've just been keeping hands here. and therefore that will slightly alter the way that everything feels, and I don't want you to feel rushed. The other reason is that although shag is a great dance for fast music, it isn't that you can only do it to fast music, you can do it to medium-paced and, you know, really quite slow music, and it can still look like an interesting dance, much the way that Lindy Hop can be danced to a range of speeds. So I'm going to put on a slower piece of music, and let's do the same exercise again of just improvising strings of moves, but this time with the hand held high.
Oh, he's got a fine brown frame. I wonder what could be his name. He looks good to me, and all I can see is his fine brown frame. How long have you been around? Mr. When did you hit this big town? I want to scream, cause I've never seen such a fine brown frame. All that I have is a broken down chair, but I would gladly make him king on my throne. Don't be a square, why don't you come over here? Together we would really be gone. Oh, he's got a fine brown frame. I wonder what could be his name. He is solid with me, and all I can see is his fine brown frame. Beep, 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 beep. He's got such a fine brown frame. I wonder what could be his name. He looks good to me, and all I can see is his fine brown frame. How long have you been around? Mister, when did you hit this big tone? I wanna scream, ow, cause I've never seen such a fine brown frame.
Okay, it's quite possible that this arm is aching now. Sorry, that was quite a long practice. And of course, when you're actually dancing with a partner, you won't be dancing face to face all the time. It will be coming down for lots of reasons. So we wouldn't normally be sustaining that position for quite so long. I'm now going to do something else, which it sort of changes the rhythm. It's still really two beat units, but we're going to do something that starts to have the feel, even in the unit of dance, of being four or more. So at the moment you have patterns like step, flick, and then that foot is going to come down for the next step. But I could decide to go step, flick, in without putting it down, flick it out again, and then put it down. So that would be, I'm going to cross slightly so you can see my foot. That's not really part of the move, I just want to do it visually. So step, flick, in, flick, and then you put it down. So if I do those on both legs, I mean, one after the other, we'd have a pattern like step in, sorry, we'd have a pattern like step, flick, in, flick, down, flick, in, flick, down, flick, in, flick, down, flick, in, flick. That's an alternative decoration. It has a sort of hesitation feel. And if I just dance the normal flick, so if I'm going, and I'll do this in double time, so step, flick, step, flick, step, 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 flick, step, flick, step, 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 flick, in, flick, step, flick, in, flick, step, flick, step, flick, step, step. That sense of that sudden step, flick, in, flick, it hasn't altogether killed the bounce, but it's created a bit of a pause in the general kind of progress that's happening in the dance. It just has this sort of punctuation feeling, which is why it's rather nice. When we're partnered, we often do this when we're side by side, so I'd have my partner next to me, this side if I'm leading. And the step, flick, in, flick is something which is really, it's a really easy timing change to pick up when you're next to somebody. And it can create a nice decoration. So let's try it together. I'm going to turn my back on you. So what we're going to do is the same pattern I just did. We're going to go step, flick, step, flick, step, step. Then we're going to go step, flick, in, flick, step, flick, in, flick, step. Okay? Five, six, and by all means have your hands down. We can practice it with a high hand later. 5, 6, 7, 8. Step, flick, step, flick, step, 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 flick, in, flick, step, flick, in, flick. Let's do the same thing, but let's now put another one of those basic step, flick, step, flick, step, steps on the end. 5, 6, 7, 8. Step, flick, step, flick, step, 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 flick, in, flick, step, flick, in, flick, step, flick, step, flick, step, step. So hopefully you felt that sense of things kind of not pausing, but there being a punctuation in the dance. It has a different feel when you do that. And this is a gentle form of the punctuation, and we're going to do a stronger form in a little while. So what I'm going to do now is to put the music on again, and we'll go to the slightly faster music and try putting that in. By all means, have a high hand for part of the time. Don't feel you have to have it up for all of the time while we're just practicing. It's not part of solo shag, it's part of partner shag. I'm trying to give you the skills for both. Okay, music. Basic timing, you can choose to decorate that with a little bit of twist in your body. So at the moment, when I've been teaching the step, flick, we've been doing it pretty much either straight on, step, flick, as we did in lesson one, or I've sometimes been taking it out to the side so that you can see more of what's going on. When I've been taking it to the side, it's been opening so far, so step, open, so that's kind of opening up to space on the side of me, step, open. But I could go the other way. I could go step, kick, and I'm kicking across myself. So I'm not taking up space to the side. Step, flick. Sorry, I should have said flick, not kick. So if we do a whole, just a step, flick, step, flick, step, step, that would look like 6, 7, 8, step, flick, step, flick, step, 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 flick, step, flick, step, step. The hangman becomes a really natural kind of step here. So I'm going to do it that way. 5, 6, 7, 8. Step, flick, hangman. Step, flick, hangman. The reason it's natural is that, you know, on the hangman we said we could go sideways. You can also very easily turn round with the hangman, and that lets you reset your direction. Let's do this together. I'm going to turn my back to you. I'm going to start with my weight on my right foot, but it really doesn't matter. You can do this, of course, in either sense. 5, 6, 7, 8. Step, flick, step, flick, step, 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 flick, step, flick, step, 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 flick. Your shoulders should not be moving much in the sense of which way they're facing. So what I mean is my shoulders are facing you. As I go step, flick, clearly my hips are now pointing that way, but my shoulders are still facing you. Step, flick. Again, my shoulders are facing you. If I do this slightly silly, artificial pointing with my hands, step, flick, step, flick, step, 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 flick, step, flick, step, step. You can see that this bit is straight along. Since this is a preparation for partnership class, I really want to stress that. If you're just doing solo shag, purely solo, you can do what you like with your upper body. But the stillness of the upper body is really important when you need to communicate leads to your partners. I've mentioned that before. So for that reason, try to practice this keeping a still upper body. Okay, let's do that again. 5, 6, 7, 8, step, flick, step, flick, step, 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 flick, step, flick, step, 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 flick, step, flick, step, step. Good. If you wanted to, you could extend that by using the flick in flick and then step on the neck on the beginning of the next bit, as we've just been doing. So I could, for example, do something like step, flick, step, flick, in, flick, step, flick, step, flick, in, flick, as a unit. Notice in the slows, what I'm doing is, in a slow, I'm putting my weight on one foot and it doesn't change during the slow, it stays there. In this, the step, in, step, it also doesn't change. So just as a six count, if I start doing this, I'll mirror reverse, but if I start this stepping in a normal six count, and I'm going to count the weight-bearing foot, it's going to be right, left, step, step, and my right in mirror reverse is ready to go again. In what we've just done, our step, flick, in, flick, we are going to go right, left, and my right in mirror image is ready to go down again at the end of that. So you can do that little thing and you'll still be on the same foot at the end as if you did a normal step, flick, step, flick, step, step. Okay? It's just a useful thing to know. Again, when you're dancing solo, it doesn't really matter. When you're dancing partner dances, you can always communicate to your partner what foot you'd like them to be on anyway, or feel that communication coming back from your partner. But sometimes for leaders particularly, it's useful to know where you expect to be. Okay, I'm going to put the music on. So we're going to experiment with this idea of kicking across ourselves. That's the main thing. But if you want to, also extend it with the flick in, flick down, rather than just going flick down. Okay, music. Music to which you've just been dancing. So this is a piece by Louis Armstrong called Mahogany Hall. It was recorded in 1929, but despite that early date, it's actually a nostalgic piece. It's looking back about 15 years to the dawn of jazz itself and to one of the places that fostered the development of jazz. As I'm sure you know, jazz has got two main cultural roots. There is a root from Africa that gave it its rhythm and some of its percussion instruments. And there is a root from Europe that gave it the equal tempered scale to which the melodies are played. That's the scale that was championed, for example, by Johann Sebastian Bach. And of course, most of the melodic instruments, trombones, saxophones, trumpets, that kind of thing, are all of European origin. And these two cultures came together. and they came together in a place where, at least in some people's minds, there was mutual respect between the cultures. Those people were rather specifically people who were born of mixed race parentage, so that they had every reason for taking seriously each of the cultures that gave rise to them and to their own culture. And just to add to the mix, in New Orleans, the European culture was of course dominated by France. So one thing that the development of jazz needed was this connection of cultures. The other thing it needed was somewhere to develop where it wouldn't be crushed by mainstream tastes. Jazz was wild, jazz was a low-life thing, it was certainly regarded as a low-brow thing, despite the immense intelligence of the people who developed it. And New Orleans had a perfect place for this. It was called Storyville, and it was New Orleans' red light district. So Storyville was a sort of famous and infamous place. It had a railroad station, where in the summer months, if you got off the train, you would have been greeted by the least expensive of the ladies who worked in Storyville, who would be literally naked on the railway platform, ready to meet any customers interested in them and take them back to their cots, which are kind of primitive cabin type affairs for plying their trade. Then on the streets, there would be many sort of bar-like places called honky-tonks, where there would be music being played, very often piano, but not always. Visitors, particularly sailors, would enter these for alcohol and also to meet women who were largely professional and who had arrangements with the bar staff for the renting of upstairs rooms by the half hour and so forth. And then there were much larger, much sort of higher class, if I can use that word, establishments, sort of large brothels, which were meant for entertaining a much richer stratum of New Orleans society. And at these places, there would be a lot of music which was being played, either when they were in direct use as brothels, because the large halls were effectively entertainment areas where customers would be waiting for their favourite bell and would need to be entertained and kept in the mood for spending their money. And then there would also be more formal entertainments, because the people who owned these places tend to be part of New Orleans high society, so they would be throwing parties for admirals and mayors and generals and all sorts of people, like senators, all sorts of people like that. The music that was played there is the music that became jazz as we know it, not as a street marching band thing, but as something that's played indoors with a high amount of skill and improvisation. So the very pioneers of jazz, people like Jelly Roll Morton, really Ferdinand Lamont, but he changed his name because he wanted to sound less French, would be working at these places. And they would be playing music to keep customers entertained. They would sometimes be singing, and they would tend to be singing some fairly explicit songs that Jelly Roll himself did set to wax recording cylinders for the Library of Congress. And they would also be playing dances, so that the very, very first jazz dancers, who were some of the women who were working in these establishments, could dance to them. If you've ever heard Jelly Roll Morton's famous piano piece, Naked Dance, the title means exactly what you think it means, because of course that is how a lot of these very early solo jazz dances were done, because of their purpose. Anyway, of these places, probably the most famous was Mahogany Hall. This photograph shows the interior of Mahogany Hall and one of the entertainment spaces that was used for large and grand parties. And this next slide shows the person who built it. Lulu White is one of the most remarkable characters in the history of New Orleans, often called the Queen of the Demi-Monde. She was, in 21st century, rather dull parlance, we call her a sex worker, I suppose, but she was a fairly original in the sorts of things that she did. She used photography for great profit. She organised acts with other women, I mean acts as in performances with other women, that were also highly profitable because she made a point of playing only to the very richest of New Orleans society and serving their needs in various ways. This also meant, because she was a good record keeper, she kept very careful records of who from the very highest parts of New Orleans society visited her, so she knew who she could go to for favours in order to keep her mouth shut. And through that trading model, she accrued a vast amount of money. She loved mahogany as a wood. She used to wear it round her neck. And when she had enough money, she built this vast brothel called Mahogany Hall, where she kept around 40 bedrooms working during the day and would then be throwing great parties for New Orleans, rich and famous, and including, you know, visiting royalty from Europe and so forth in the evenings. She was a great sponsor of early jazz. I've already mentioned Jelly Roll Morton. He was a regular player to people who were waiting for the services there. And so were many other people in the very early days of jazz. Louis Armstrong, who played that piece, Mahogany Hall Stomp, did not, as far as I know, work in Mahogany Hall himself. He was almost certainly too young and too little known up to the time that the place, along with the rest of Storyville, was closed in 1917. But he did work as a musician in a small honky-tonk nearby until he decided instead to take to a life of pimping, was nearly killed by being stabbed, and then went back to music but left New Orleans and joined King Oliver in Chicago, which is where his career really took off. He almost certainly called his piece after Mahogany Hall because it was the most famous of all of these places that sponsored early jazz. The stomp bit is interesting. So the stomp wouldn't really fit the demographic of Mahogany Hall, but it would have fitted the demographic of the honky-tonks that Louis Armstrong did know as a child or a young teenager. The stomps were the very, very first types of dance music that was meant for jazz partner dancing rather than for the solo jazz dance that was done by the women in the brothels. And the very early jazz dances were things like the Grizzly Bear, which we'll happily teach a taster of, but they were very, very close-hold dances because the entire point, they were not complicated to learn. I could teach you the Grizzly Bear in a quarter of an hour and you'd know everything. They were really not difficult to learn because the whole point was just to have a dance that brought men and women in very close physical contact. And these were danced a lot in the honky-tonks on the dance floors. Okay, I just shared that with you just to give you a perspective about why a piece is called Mahogany Hall Stomp, and also to tell you a little bit about where jazz came from. Because however wholesome and arty and highbrow jazz may be considered now, its origins were very, very much in the underworld. I will put, for anybody who's interested in Lulu's story or in the story of Storyville itself, I'm going to put two links on the links at the end. One of them is a superb video documentary of the history of Storyville. One of them is a podcast, which is a discussion by two modern day sex workers about their take on Lulu White's life. Both of them are excellent for intelligent discussions of history, but I must warn you that because of the subject material, both of them are quite explicit, and if you're of a sensitive disposition, you probably want to give them a miss. Right, I'm sure you've got your breath back now because, as usual, I've talked for far too long, so let's get back to dancing. A feature of what we've just done, the flick in, flick down, is that feeling of punctuation and of breaking this sort of the otherwise rather relentless, gentle pulse of this dance. There's another way that we break the rhythm, and it's broken so much that this is actually called breaks. So I'll do it facing you first, but then I'll turn sideways because it may be more obvious when I turn sideways. What I'm going to do is to dance a step, flick, step, flick, step, step as normal. Then I'm going to do a break version of it, and then I'm going to do it to a normal version. So we're going to do these six beat unit three times, but in normal form, break form, and normal form. So it's going to be 6, 7, 8, step, flick, step, flick, step, step, ha, ha, step, 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 flick, step, flick, step, step. So if I turn sideways, the normal one, we've got our little pulse going, so we have our, which is emergent, I'm not driving it, it just happens. So we have our step, flick, step, flick, step, step. And then what I'm going to do is just sort of sink onto this weight-bearing foot, as if I'm sitting, as if there's a bar stool behind. I mean, don't exaggerate it too much, but there's a feeling of sitting down, and there isn't a pulse, there's emphatically not a pulse. You know, when we were learning the foot behind, I was going step, hmm, to emphasise that continuing pulse with a hmm. Here there is not. So if I do it from that, so for example, I'd be going step, hmm, step, hmm, step, step, ha. No hmm, just a feeling of ah, just resting downwards. You can switch feet, ah. And then if you want to re-establish a pulse, come back up to a step, step. Or if you wanted to do this twice, it would be ah, ah, and your step, step would still be quite soft. Step, step, ah, ah, that, of course, the sound effect is not necessary. My R is just made so that you can hear it. And typically, even if you were wearing shoes, you would probably slide your feet in that because it's so soft, you're kind of on the floor rather than kicking above the floor. So if I'm careful and I don't slide my feet, normally the double kicks won't be touching the floor, but that will. Let me turn my back to you and let's do that together. So we're going to do a step, flick, step, flick, step, step, and then that sitting ah feeling where you're just extending your foot forward, sitting on that one and not doing anything at all for the second beat. 5, 6, 7, 8, step, flick, step, flick, step, step, ah, ah, step, 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 flick, step, flick, step, step. Again. 5, 6, 7, 8, step, flick, step, flick, step, step, ah, ah, step, 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 flick, step, flick, step, step. And this has a feeling of rest. Excuse me. You can also do it taking your feet out behind you. This time I'm going to start my way to my left foot. So it'll be something like step, flick, step, flick, step, step, ah, ah. Step, 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 flick, step, flick, step, step. So I'm going with my foot behind, either on the ground or it can be up. One of the reasons it's important to learn these both ways, especially if you're a leader, you will tend, if you have a partner, to be doing this forwards. And obviously, your partner would have to be doing it backwards because otherwise you'd kick each other. There is a body lean which happens automatically. If I'm doing this, you can see there's a slight backwards lean. I can't help it. And that will communicate to your partner that your partner has to have the matching forwards lean, which will quite naturally take their foot out backwards. So it's not that you have to learn an elaborate code to do all this as a partnership. It's actually, it really is, if by the time you've got to doing this sort of thing with partners, it will just work. So let's just put some gentle music on and try putting those resting modes. Oh, sorry, you can also do it sideways. You can also sort of go out to the side, 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 which is quite different from side, kick, step, step. This is the bouncy form. Well, not bouncy, but the normal form. And then we've got ah, ah. See how very kind of dead this is compared to that. It just sort of deadens the pace. You wouldn't want to dance like this all the time. This is a spice. This is something that you use maybe a couple of these in succession and then you pick up the rhythm again. The way that musicians will sometimes be kind of, you know, take things down a bit and then pick up again. Okay, let me put some music on. By the way, you don't have to hold these for just two beats. I was aware in that last piece, there was a part where I actually went 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So I was holding the ahs for four whole beats. Okay, we have now reached the part of the class where we add another verse to Sergei's choreography of Killer Boogie, and you'll be pleased to know probably this is actually quite a short verse. Let me remind you what we've already had. So we had our verse that consisted entirely of, I'm going to turn my back to you, we had our verse that consisted entirely of flick, 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 step, step, which you now know is the double rhythm and basic with the flick, flicks. Then we had our verse that went, that had our gadas, 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 and our running, and our shimmying, and the flick, 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 step, 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 and then the sweeps around. And then we had our verse that went to the steps to the side, like this. And then last time we had our verse that went tap in, flick, down, frog. So that was 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Clap on the 8. And then 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 1, 3, 5, 6, 7, 8. Okay. That's what we've had so far. Let's dance it as a warm-up. Pleased that the new verse is only 4/8 long and it uses things that you already know, but I'm going to show you a workaround for something which you may find difficult on a high friction surface. And actually I think the workaround looks pretty good, so we'll use it anyway if you want to. I'll turn my back to you. The first 8 is full of something you already know. It's our 8 count basic that goes flick, 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 step, 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 step. We had one of those in verse 2. Let's do that together. My weight is on my right foot as I'm coming in. 5, 6, 7, 8. Flick, 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 step, 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 step. What we're then going to do in the full choreography version is to come out, in, out, in, out, in. So, and out in it. So it's like the Kadurka does, but we're going to accentuate it with our arms to go out, 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 out. Because the music, the pianist is hitting glissandi there. He's sort of rushing up the keyboard by kind of going up the keys. And this is happening. So we're expanding our space as he's creating this feeling of tonal expansion on the piano. This is difficult to do on, I mean, I'm even finding this difficult to do on this wooden surface in bare feet. I'm kind of longing for my dance shoes. If you're on carpet, you probably would find this quite hard. So I think an alternative is to have your feet a little bit beyond hip width apart and just be going like that and have your knees coming apart. So you're just going with bent knees, you're expanding your knees out like that. So I'm just, my knees are still, you know, bent forwards, but side, but sort of coming out to the side, in, side, side, side. And that creates, especially with the arms, you're definitely hitting that glissando feeling without having to do too much with your feet. That's a workaround. I quite like it, and I will probably use it on this surface. I think it's only on a proper kind of proper shoes and proper surface that we're doing the real thing. Then what we're doing, two things that you know, even in this order. So we're going to run, but we're going to run very gently. So I'm going to call it jogging, because the music is quite gentle there, for 8 beats. And then we're going to shimmy for 8 beats, just as we did in verse whatever it was, verse 2. So if we put the whole thing together, and then we do this together, we're going to have our 8 count, flick, 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 step, 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 step. We're going to have our outwards with the sandy. Then we're going to have our jogs for 8 counts and our shimmy for 8 counts. Let's do that together. Five, and our weight is starting on our right foot. 5, 6, 7, 8. Flick, 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 step, 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 step. Out, 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 out. Jog, 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 jog. Shimmy, 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 shimmy. Okay. Let's do that once more. Right foot. 5, 6, 7, 8. Flick, 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 step, 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 step. Out, out, out. Out. Jog, 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 jog. Shimmy, 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 shimmy. And now let's try the whole piece from the very top. There are about 4 more verses to go, by the way, which fits rather neatly into the semester structure. That's all that we're doing today. I'm going to leave you with a clip of a couple dancing shag all over the place, in the sense of in many different places in the world. And if you watch them, you will recognise very many of the footwork variations you already know. And if you keep a sharp eye out, you'll see the break time that we learned today brought into their dancing. You'll also see the high hand. Okay, thank you very much for carrying on following these classes, and I shall see you again next week. Bye for now.